Welcome to Maine Arts Magazine. My name is Ed Morin. Our co-host Judy Sobol is in Europe. Right now she's probably in Spain, examining the architecture of Antonio Gaudi. Judy is director of the Joan Whitney Payson Gallery of Art at Westport College in Portland. The Payson Gallery has mounted a very interesting exhibition we'd like to tell you about. It's called Women Pioneers in Maine Art, 1900 to 1945.
Although it's recorded at the time, and although they got good reviews at the time, and although a number of them made a good living at the time, they somehow, in the slipstream of history, they do not get picked up.
And so it becomes, I think, our responsibility as historians and as art historians to write women back into history.
67 works by 25 women artists associated with Maine are on exhibit at the Payson Gallery. The show was a follow-up to a highly successful exhibition at the gallery in 1981, which looked at women art pioneers of the 19th century. Bill Berry has guest curated both shows.
The paintings, the objects that were selected, paintings, prints, and drawings, are really very diverse. You have some very modern, for that period, very advanced works. You have some very traditional works. I think in terms of George O'Keeffe, for example, and Marguerite Zorak as being very much in the vanguard of what was going on. I think of somebody like Lucy Hayward Barker, who grew up in Presque Isle, was born in Portage Lake, as being more traditional. She studied in Boston. She comes off with some very interesting portraits of Episcopal bishops that are very rich, very turn of the century, nicely done, but very, very different than what George O'Keeffe is doing.
We feel that these are works of art that deserve to be seen, no matter who made them, no matter when they were made. They are works that reflect creative spirits and a very unusual time, within a time of great aesthetic stresses and changes. You've looked at and you've heard about the regionalist movement. The regionalist movement not only returned to native subject matter, nostalgic subject matter, it also sought a backing away from modernist aesthetics that many people felt were alien imports from Europe. And while people were returning to a regionalist kind of art, others were more interested in these if you will, European imports. Recent scholarship in the last 10 years have shown that those are not necessarily, modernism is not necessarily a European import. And we are hoping that the scholarship that went into the creation of this exhibition will right misconceptions, just as general scholarship in American art over the last 10 years has shown the contribution, the basic contribution of the 20th century to modernism, period.
The work that I looked at from the show, I found women exploring, I think, further and in new ways than they had before 1900, both in terms of subject matter and technique and style. And part of that, I think, has a great deal to do with the different status that women have in the 20th century, that they had worked very hard both during the 19th and I think during the 20th century. And the obvious statement of that effort is the passage of the 19th Amendment, women's right to vote. Mm-hmm. And I think with
Joan Uranek right, says she thinks Peggy Bacon's Antique Beauty epitomizes the Women Pioneers show.
Because it shows, it's a small painting, oil painting, of a an older woman with her mink coat and feathered cap coming into a gallery of modern sculpture surrounded by nude female sculptures. And she's confronted with confronted with the rise of a new form of art and of modernism and of values that aren't hers.
I think I agree with both Bill and Joan in the case of this exhibition that these are works that are, their content is not gender oriented, nor is their style gender oriented. This is not the kind of work that most of these women were doing. It's not what the exhibition is about. The exhibition is about creating or correcting scholarship and giving people a larger sense of what was happening in Maine during the first half of this century, rather than a narrow sense, which is basically an incorrect point of view, the scholarship that left out women.
Yeah, I think 1945 is a very convenient cutoff date. It's the end of World War II. There's a whole shifts in attitudes and changes, and it would seem that women who had played a pretty vital role across the country and in Maine as well, in the WPA and in a variety of exhibition opportunities. Somehow the 50s seem, at this point, and we haven't gone into any great detail, but seem to be a real desert area. The advances made by women just seem to have to dry up in that period and rebound a little later. But I think it has to do with women having worked during the war and men returning from overseas and that sort of thing. There's a whole complexity of things that I don't really think we should get into here because we haven't studied them that closely. But there's a major change around that time, and 45 rather than 50 seems to be the cutoff.
The cutoff for seeing women pioneers in Maine art, 1900 to 1945 at the Payson Gallery, is May 19th. Joan Uranek will be visiting Presque Isle, Bar Harbor, and Kennebunk in the coming weeks with a film, a lecture, and slides connected with the Women Pioneers show. Uranek's presentation and the show at the Payson Gallery are made possible through a major grant by the Maine Humanities Council. I don't know if it's true or not, but it seems like the busiest students on the university campus are the theater majors. On April 23rd, the Maine Masque Theatre at the University of Maine at Orono opens its next major production, Shakespeare's A Midsummer Night's Dream. The play is keeping a lot of students busy and teaching them a thing or two in the process.
Our vows to her and me put in two scales will even weigh, and both as light as tails.
I had no judgment when to her I swore.
No, not in my mind. Now you give her all.
The story of how I decided to do the play has to do with an enrichment program that we had last year here when we brought the Royal Shakespeare Company, or a small portion of it here, to for a week's residency to take over our classes and to do some public performances and so on. And this set the students and the faculty on fire. And students began to say, oh, well, I wish we could do a Shakespearean play next year. So that sort of sent the mind off in that direction. Well, of course, Midsummer Night's Dream happens to be one of Shakespeare's plays to which nearly everything that could be done has been done at one time or another. Traditionally, it's been used in many kinds of ways, used and misused, and done in a great variety of ways. In looking for some general approach, especially a visual approach, we thought we would give it something to the feeling of a mask, M-A-S-Q-U-E, mask of the period. It's a very funny play, a very animated kind of play, not to be taken too seriously.
Your stern cruelty, yet you, the murderer, look as bright, as clear as yonder Venus in a glimmering sphere.
What's this to my Lysander? Where is he? Ah, good Demetrius, wilt thou give him me?
I'd rather give his carcass to my hounds.
Out, dog! Out, thou drives me past the bounds of...
One thing Arnold Kolbath and the other members of UMO's theater faculty seem to take very seriously is a commitment to providing students a good theater background with chances for some hands-on experience.
I don't think anyone suffers from the illusion that 4 years of college as a theater major prepares one to be a professional actor without further study, of course. But the process has to be begun somewhere and the foundation laid. I wouldn't think one needed to go very far to justify doing any play by Shakespeare in a university situation. It stretches the actors. It's one of the most entertaining forms of theater, and not to do Shakespeare in a theater department would be like not playing Mozart in a music department, it seems to me.
Okay. Don Coleman spent 10 years in New York as a technical director in professional theater. This year, he's technical director on the UMO theater faculty.
The two major reasons that I wanted to come up here and do university theater is, first of all, to teach. When I was an undergraduate, I always resented being taught by people who didn't know what they, who had no professional experience. And especially after I got off and did some summer stock myself, and I could come back and say, who are you? I've done more shows professionally than you have. Why are you teaching me? Why do you presume, you know? Which is a bit of a narrow viewpoint, but I can also understand to some extent why students would take it. I think it's better, although not essential, if you have some professional experience. So I wanted to teach all along, but I didn't want to do that before I really had something significant to teach. And a university theater can be, in a funny sort of way, a little bit of a playground, you know. It's not even the freedom to make mistakes, it's the freedom to change your mind in order to do it better. You see some way of doing it better in production process, you can go back and revise it.
In New York, Don Coleman had to pay expensive union wages any time changes had to be made. At the University of Maine at Orono, he makes the changes himself. As a faculty member, how does Coleman prepare students for the realities of professional theater?
What I try to do is to give people enough technique to be able to do anything. And theatrical techniques and the basics don't vary all that much from academic to professional to amateur theater. Most people will build a flat the same way. Lights are lights, and the same lights will do the same thing. The crew situations may be different and so forth, but the basics are really basic. So I try to do that and then encourage people to learn how to think creatively using those tools.
Well, I think one of the strongest factors of our department has to do with its size. This is, we are on a university campus and a part of a university, but as a department, we're relatively small, let's say, as to numbers on the faculty and numbers of students. And this means that students who choose to come here to major in theater, for example, you get, for that reason, a great deal of opportunity. They really get a chance to do things, and we try to do what we can to back them. For example, student directors, in order to direct, they need the opportunity to direct in order to learn how to do it. And we're not too bashful about making the Pavilion Theater over here available to them, and so on. We opened this season with Sticks and Bones, directed by an undergraduate student as a major production to open our season. And if one is not willing to do that kind of thing, then it seems to me one's in danger of really not doing justice by the students. You have to open up opportunities for them.
Stephen Smith is finishing up a master's program in theater at UMO.
I got the nod to do the lighting design on the show largely through the efforts of Don Coleman, who went to bat for me and said, why don't we give Steve a crack at designing lights for this? There was a course offered this semester just on this play that the director, Arnold Kohlbath, taught. So we've been discussing the play now for some 10 or 11 weeks. So I've had a lot of time to let it sink in and react to it. So I've been developing these ideas along and watching Don work, Don doing his drawings, building the scenery, discussing his ideas with me. Especially I act as kind of a shop foreman for him. He does he sits down and designs a lot of this. The student workers come in and I act as kind of the liaison between him as a designer and our student carpenters.
Our students of the last 15 years or so have been much more adventuresome about going out into the world and trying to make a go of a career in theater. It takes a while for them to do it, but we have students who are acting in off-Broadway shows, in soaps. I see numbers of them every once in a while doing professional commercials, and they're very well paid for this, of course. Again, one understands they have to have more experience, they even have to have more training. But they're no longer just settling to do, for doing community theater work, or necessarily feeling that all they can do is teach, otherwise there's no opportunity. They're willing to go out and to plug away at it, and thus some of them are beginning to get the opportunity.
Cut whatever this thing is with that.
Okay.
That's one of the extra things. It's all right, but it's not that effective,
yeah.
So it's worth sacrificing.
Yeah.
But there's another time when you give us a kind of, and it's more cute than anything else. It really doesn't count for anything.
Okay.
And it becomes embroidery.
Okay,
it's one of the kinds of things that I mentioned that is stopping the speech. Then when you hit the deck here, going backwards, don't react as though you, the actor, have been hurt, which is what they're going to think.
All right.
It doesn't sound like Puck, it sounds like you have been hurt. We don't want to concern them with that. And it doesn't really add anything meaningful to it. Sorry to fall the way you do all that, just don't react to it in that way. It butts right into the flow of the speech.
Okay, yeah. Just keep it flowing.
And I think with just those two or three things out of there, the thing will begin to get more continuity, and flow will flow a little bit better.
The Maine Masque Theatre at the University of Maine in Orono presents Shakespeare's A Midsummer Night's Dream, April 23rd through 27th. Now, let's take a look at some other arts events happening during the next month.
An exhibition of 94 old master drawings from the permanent collection of the Bowdoin College Museum of Art will open in Brunswick on May 17th and runs through July 8th. For information, phone 725-8731, extension 275. An exhibit of marine paintings and a show of drawings opens April 27th at the Winterport Art Gallery, Route 1A, Winterport. Phone 223-5770. On Friday, May 3rd, the Portland School of Art holds its annual auction. The preview is at 5, the bidding begins at 7. The phone number is 775-3052. The play Mass Appeal will be presented in the Alumni Theater at the University of Maine at Farmington. Curtain is 7:30 p.m. April 25th through 27th. Call 778-6910. The University of Southern Maine's Russell Square Players will present the rock fantasy Gint in Russell Theater in Gorham. Curtain is 8 p.m. on April 19th and 20th and 2 p.m. April 20th and 21st. For reservations, call 780-5483. The York County Ballet is presenting Igor Stravinsky's Firebird at Portsmouth High School Auditorium Friday and Saturday, May 3rd and 4th at 8 p.m., and Sunday, May 5th at 2 p.m. For information, phone area code 603-430-9309. The UMO Mini Dance Company will be performing in the Hancock County Auditorium Ellsworth Saturday, April 20th at 8 p.m. Phone 667-5911. There'll be a gathering of cellists on Saturday, May 11th in Portland City Hall Auditorium featuring George Sopkin of the New England Piano Quartet. The symposium begins at 9 a.m. A public performance is at 4 in the afternoon. For more information, contact Dick Noyes at 892-2241 or 761-4639.
Let's take a look now at another aspect of theater, writing plays. The playwrights we're interested in are several Maine high school students.
Portland Stage Company is a professional theater with an active youth outreach program. This outreach includes bringing students to the Portland Performing Arts Center for matinees and sending PSC interns to schools through the state. This year, with funds from the Maine State Commission on the Arts and Humanities, Portland Stage worked with well-known playwright Paula Sismar, who went to a number of Maine high schools and helped students write their own scripts. Several of these scripts were read aloud a few weeks ago by a group of Portland Stage Company actors.
That's what was very important.
Barbara Rozoff is artistic director of the Portland Stage Company.
They may have been reading cold, but it was the coming to life of a play for the first time, which is a thing that only the theater does. I mean, it brings to life the written word. A play is not complete until it's put in the hands of actors, speaking it in front of a live audience responding to it, and that was what today was about, and that sort of...
Plays by 7 students from South and Central Maine were read, including a scene set around a campfire written by Cape Elizabeth High School student Kurt Bauman.
He's just jealous because you're 11 years younger than he is, and you can get girls. John used to be a real ladies' man, too, but his wife found out and divorced him. He makes jokes to help himself feel better.
And I thought he was just an obnoxious pig.
Because the actors, the professionals that performed it, brought out some of the subtle humor and you know, the intricacies of the work that I didn't know existed. Perhaps my subconscious was at work putting them in there, but I was proud to have done this and seen it in this format. I think it was very helpful for me.
One of the things that we are very committed to is to try and illuminate to as many people in the community, particularly those in the young community, what the power of theater is. And we do that through our school matinee program by bringing students in here to see work. We've started touring to young audiences through our intern touring program for young children. But we also wanted to provide an avenue where students could realize their own creative potential through the theater, and maybe by doing that, find out what the power of theater could be. It would be wonderful if some of these students became playwrights, but even if they don't become playwrights in the future, the fact that they've realized that the theater has a very specific thing to offer them is the form of creative expression.
I don't really desire to make playwriting my career. I'm thinking perhaps to go into theater. I have had experience in many forms of theater. I've been in plays at school. I've come to the Portland Stage Company and watched their performances. And I think the playwriting workshops give me a chance to experience a different facet of this art that I had perhaps not come in contact with before. I had never written a play. It was, you know, very new to me, and it was a difficult experience. So I'm glad I had the chance to actually do this.
The kids who were here today, the 7 plays that we read, of about 15 that were submitted, I think got the pure value of the experience, the whole value. Those other 8 kids who wrote and weren't here today, for whatever reason they couldn't get here, I hope somebody reads their play out loud to them and makes live. I hope the other kids who never wrote are provoked by their teachers. I think that the schools may need to make a more concerted effort to some kind of continuity. We did find that the schools that were willing to put this program into their curricular day as opposed to an after-school event were more successful in engaging their students than those who chose to have it on a, if you want to come after school, Paula says, Merle, I'll be here for 3 hours today. Those did not succeed. And in fact, the one school that handled it that way didn't have any plays submitted. And that was a disappointment, because there were kids in that school who deserved to be heard. And I think it needs more support and structure from the school system.
One of Maine's best-known writers is May Sarton. Norton just published a volume of her poems entitled Letters from Maine. And in September, Norton will publish May Sarton's next novel, The Magnificent Spinster. 3 years ago, 3 days after her 70th birthday, May Sarton came to visit us at MPBN. She was in Portland to do a reading at Westbrook College. She gave the reading as a benefit for the school's Maine Women Writers Collection.
The roar of Big Surf, and above it all night the peepers, singing out so sweet and frail. Above the pounding roar that wears down rock, they dare. They try to connect through the gale. And if that relentless boom might seem to mock those who still risk their hope before daylight, that song suggests something is going right, whatever locked love cannot bear to do. The tree frogs can, and spring is breaking through.
You know, we've talked about your novels, and yet, from what I've read, you like your poetry better, or you like the process of poetry better?
Not that. I think if you're a poet at all, you're a poet first, because a poet is a gift that's given to you, if you like, by God. But I mean, like musical genius or mathematical genius, it shows itself very early. You cannot write a poem on will, whereas you can write, if you're an intelligent person, and you have some talent for writing, you can write a novel, but you cannot write a poem unless you have the gift, you see. So it's a And you can't write them on will. And I think it's a much rarer gift. There are fewer good poets than there are good novelists, far fewer. And the chances of it lasting, if you're a good poet, I think are much greater than for the novel. I really don't know of myself, but certainly if I were in solitary confinement and knew that nothing would ever be published again, I would still write poems, but I would not write novels. Old trees, how exquisite the white blossom on the gnarled branch. Thickened trunk, erratic shape, battered by winter winds, bent in the long cold. Young ones may please the aesthete, but old trees, the miracle of their flowering against such odds, bring healing. Let us praise them and sing hosannas as the small buds grow red just before they open. And what you do if you're a poet is you spend your whole life trying to be a good instrument for poetry. And now and then you are a good instrument and then it flows through you and you can write it. But you can't write it all the time. And this is why I'm so lucky to have other strings to my bow. It was written, I suppose, around 1950. Can that be possible? 30 years ago, when I was beginning to feel rather old. And had my first gray hair. Well, I went back to it, and it's such a wonderful poem for me now. It's as if that person 30 years ago had written it for this person now. And I'm very grateful to her. On a winter night, I sat alone in a cold room, feeling old, strange, at the year's change in firelight. Last fire of youth, all brilliance burning, and my year turning, one dazzling rush like a wild wish or blaze of truth. First fire of age, and the soft snow of ash below. For the clean wood, the end was good. For me, an image. For then I saw that fires, not I, burn down and die. That flare of gold turns old, turns cold. Not I. I grow. Nor old nor young, the burning sprite of my delight, a salamander in fires of wonder gives tongue.
And that's Maine Arts Magazine. We'd like to thank the Portland School of Art for letting us use their Baxter Gallery. This building on Congress Street used to be the Portland Public Library. The upper levels have been transformed into a delightful, airy gallery space. The Portland School of Art's alumni show will be up at the Baxter Gallery through April 27th. If you'd like to write us concerning Maine Arts Magazine, the address is Maine Arts Magazine, Post Office Box 1628, Portland, Maine, 04104. And we hope you join us next month for Maine Arts Magazine.